Hello everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video I'm going to show you how you can obfuscate your .NET application, and this mostly focuses on .NET Core and 5 and 6, not really framework, and why no matter what you do, it's kind of pointless. Now I totally get it, it's probably a business requirement, you want to ship some code to someone else's desktop PC, or maybe you have an Electron application wrapping a Blazor server side, and you want to make sure they can't tamper with it, maybe you have a license, maybe you have secrets, I hope you don't. But maybe you do, and you want to protect them, and you want to scramble things around in the code, and that process is called obfuscation, making it hard for them to crack it. Now, no matter what you do, things are crackable, especially a VM language like C#, which is running on the CLR, can pretty easily be cracked by someone skilled, no matter the obfuscation lengths you go to. However, I'm still going to show you how to do it, because like I said before, in some cases, it is a business requirement. And it's also good knowledge to know how obfuscation works, how deobfuscation works and decompilation works, and the common attacks and things you should be looking for. If you like this type of content and you want to see more, make sure you subscribe and ring the notification bell to get alerted when I upload a new video. So what do I have here? I have a web API application here with controllers, a startup.cs, a program.cs, and then the forecast.cs. Classic setup, the boilerplate setup. Oh, and by the way, I should say that if you're running this on your own service, you're not shipping it to someone else's PC as a product, you don't need to worry about any of this. This is only for those who are shipping software to other people's PCs as a product. So what I want to do is I'm going to go ahead here and I'm going to do a .NET run. This is a .NET 6 application. I'm going to do the .NET run and let it build. And then you can see the APIs exposed and get ready to be blind in 3, 2, 1 now. So I'm going to call that endpoint. And as you can see, I'm getting the temperatures, the boilerplate example. Now, what I want to do is I want to publish this application. So I'm going to stop it. Then I'm going to do .NET publish and I'm going to do a C release, even though I think publish is always release. Anyway, this will create the actual final product that we want to ship somewhere. And I'm going to go to this location here, and it is here in this publish folder. And what I'll do is I'm going to create a second one, and I'm going to call that publish obf. So on this first one in the publish, I can go here and double click on this exe. And as you can see, the API is running and you're going to be blind again. Here we go. This API is running. This is accepting calls in here. The thing we just published. Now, here's the thing. I can use a decompiler like .peak, which is a JetBrains product, by the way. And sorry for the scaling. It doesn't allow me to change the size for some reason. But I can go here and I can go to publish and I can select the DLL, which is where the actual code for this is, not the exe. And as you can see, this is loaded and it tells me it's a .NET Core app v6. And I can expand these things and I can see the program.cs with all its glory. As you can see here, we have the main method. We have basically, we have the exact same code we just had in Visual Studio Code or here. Now you see these comments. Usually compiled things don't have comments. The reason why these comments exist, and I'm going to go and delete that from here, is because we have this PDB file, which is the program debug database file. This thing contains information about our application and it makes it easier to debug the published thing, even though we don't have access to the original source code. Now, if you're shipping this to someone else's PC, you most likely won't have that because it makes it very easy to get all the debug symbols and tamper with your application. So let's delete that and then open that DLL again. As you can see now, no comments now because comments don't get compiled and the format looks a bit different. We have this nullable enable things that were added here and a bunch of other stuff that .peak decompiled. And you can see that the program.cs also looks different. It's a bit weird, this lengthy thing. And then you have all that data. I can still see what's happening here. I have a random thing. I'm selecting a random summary and I'm printing 5 of them, you know, so nothing special. So how do we hide this? How do we obfuscate this? Well, I can go back here to the obf file. And what I want to do is I want to copy this location and go to this program here called .NET Reactor. Again, sorry for the size. I can't really make this bigger for you, I don't think. Yeah, I can't. So sorry, I'm going to zoom in. But this will allow me to obfuscate my project. Now, this is a commercial product. This video is not sponsored by it. I have found that it just makes it easy to explain the compilation and show you with a GUI how things are coming together. So what I want to do is I'm going to say open here and then go to that location. I'm here and then select that DLL, and the DLL is now loaded here. I have some information about it. It says the target is .NET 6 and all that. And now down here in the quick settings, I'm going to enable a few things. First, Necrobit is a powerful protection technology to stop any decompiling. Okay, select that. Anti-tampering to make sure it can be modified later. Sure. Anti-debug, so we can't debug it when it's running. Fine. Control flow obfuscation. Sure. Level 9, yes. Hide method calls. Bunch of stuff. Compress and encrypt resources. Sure, why not? So we did a bunch of stuff, and I'm going to go here and say protect. And this will kick off the process. And as you can see, succeeded, and it created this secure bunch of things. Now, we don't want the PDB again. We want to use the DLL and the dependencies, and that's it. So I go back here, delete the PDP, and override these files. And then I'm going to go to that location. Here we go. And I'm just going to run it. And as you can see, this application, the thing we just obfuscated, works and runs with the right log messages and everything. And if I blind you again, you can see that this all works fine. Nothing broke, nothing changed. However, let's take a look at what that DLL looks like now. I'm going to keep the old one in here so we can compare. And I'm going to open a new one, which can be found in publish op and here. Again, this looks fine. Nothing changed here. But when I expanded, you can see a bunch of nonsense names over here. You know, what is that thing? Effectively, what obfuscation tries to do is just scramble things around enough so it makes it hard for you to even care to understand what's happening. As you can see, this is code now in that assembly that's running and doesn't make any sense. What is that? What's this? You know, it looks very weird. If I go to the program.cs, look how that looks now. We have a main method, which we're unable to decompile this method because I don't know, dot pick kind of went, I don't know what to do with this. We have a bunch of no inlining method implementations. This is mostly for the JIT compiler. And then if I go to definition for anything in here, this all just looks weird. And in fact, here we go. Yeah, so marshalling, what is that? What is happening here? This looks very weird. And yet, our application is working. Now, if I search for temperature C, which is based on an object in this assembly, you can see that the name of that property is still here. But that looks still weird. Someone who doesn't know what this is can be a bit confused about it. Now, please understand that if you're using reflection in places and it's not done in a proper way with name offs and stuff like that, this will potentially break reflection. It will break your application. So be very careful when you're even using that. This isn't cheap either. All these redirections are going to cost you in performance when you're shipping this and when you're running this. If I just stop this and go back and show you the controller, what that looks like. Again, it's bonkers. I can totally understand that this is the random thing that I had, you know, up top in that previous library. Let's go back here and expand that, go controllers. So, you know, I can understand that something is using that randomizer, but I have no clue what's going on here. This has done a pretty decent job throwing me off. Pretty cool, right? Now, here's the thing. This can be dangerous both for the stability of your application, and you have to test everything once you obfuscate because things can break during runtime and you would never know about it. Then you have to make sure that anything that uses reflection or anything fancy like that doesn't break either. And then even if you do that, you can definitely hook to this during runtime and do any manipulation you want. If you're downloading like a secret or something to compare against your running application, maybe you have a hardware ID that you're protecting against, which is a composite ID by many components of your user's hardware, that can all be cracked very easily. You can hijack the calls, you can change things in the assembly, the final thing, even during runtime or before runtime as well. Nothing is safe, even if you do that, but this can definitely help you with people that don't know what they're doing. Now, like I mentioned, Dot Reactor is a paid product. This video is not sponsored again, but if you want to have good obfuscators, you're most likely going to pay. The open source ones are decent, but they're pretty basic. Now, ultimately, my advice is that no matter what you do, things will be cracked. So Don't bet that even if you do this, you're safe. You're not. However, hopefully now you know how to obfuscate your application, see how it compiles, decompiles, and learn something about the debug symbols as well. That's all I have for you for this video. Thank you very much for watching. Special thanks to my Patreons for making this video possible. If you want to support me as well, you're going to find a link in the description down below. Leave a like if you like this video, subscribe for more, like this and ring the bell as well, and I'll see you in the next video. Keep coding.